Hello and welcome to BYJU'S IAS. Before we begin today's analysis, we have a small announcement. The second free mock test has been uploaded on our website and the link for the same will be provided in the description box and in the comment section below. So those who are preparing for prelims, kindly take up the mock test and you will also receive the correct answers along with the explanation after you complete the test. You can even check your score on our website. So we hope you make good use of this facility. So let's get started with the analysis of today's The Hindu newspaper, beginning with an article from the front page of the Delhi edition. A Kargil war hero has been declared as a foreigner by the foreigner tribunal which has been set up in Assam. A veteran of the Kargil war has been declared as a foreigner by the foreigner tribunal and he has been placed under detention by the Assam border police. This highlights the drawbacks of the ongoing NRC exercise and it also raises questions over the credibility of the foreigner tribunals and the manner in which they are functioning. We have discussed the NRC exercise and its various drawbacks under various sessions. You can go back and watch the analysis for the 13th of March to understand what the NRC exercise is all about. And during some of the previous sessions, we have even spoken about the credibility of the foreigner tribunal and the manner in which they are functioning. One of the biggest drawbacks of the NRC exercise is that third parties can raise objection against the inclusion of others under the NRC list. For example, a person A can raise an objection against the inclusion of person B in the NRC list. And in such a case, the responsibility is on this individual to prove his citizenship. Otherwise, he can be declared as a foreigner or an illegal migrant by the foreigner tribunals. Around 100 foreigner tribunals have been set up in Assam to deal with the issue of foreigners, illegal migrants and also the D voters or doubtful voters. But experts have raised questions over the manner in which these foreigner tribunals have been constituted. Those who have been appointed by the government of Assam to head these foreigner tribunals, they lack the adequate judicial or administrative experience and some of the appointments have also been political in nature. So these loopholes which exist in the NRC exercise and in the manner in which the foreigner tribunals are functioning can be easily misused by the native tribes to target the minority communities. This mechanism can be easily misused by the majority community to target the minority community. A number of cases have come up wherein genuine Indian citizens and their family members have been declared as foreigners by the foreigner tribunals. And that is the reason why human rights organizations are worried that the ongoing NRC exercise and the manner in which the foreigner tribunals are functioning could trigger a massive humanitarian crisis in the state of Assam. The D voters or doubtful voters, they belong to a category of voters in Assam who have been disenfranchised by the government on the account of their inability to prove their citizenship. Since the state of Assam had witnessed a huge influx of illegal migrants, especially after 1971, the Election Commission ordered an exercise in 1997 to remove the non-citizens from the electoral list. It directed the government of Assam to carry out a revision of the electoral rolls by conducting a door-to-door survey. And those who were not able to provide adequate documents to prove their nationality, they were marked with a D against their name in the voters list. And these voters are not given the electoral card, they cannot contest in the elections and they cannot cast their vote in the elections. And further, the Election Commission has directed that those who have been declared as D voters, they should be tried by the foreigner tribunals which have been constituted under the Foreigner Tribunal Order of 1964. And even the Guwahati High Court has ordered that the D voters should be tried by the foreigner tribunals and if they are declared as foreigners, they should be kept in detention camps by the border police. Till date, the Election Commission has declared around 370,000 people as D voters and the most affected community are the Bengali Hindus who have migrated before 1971 from East Pakistan and after 1971 from Bangladesh. According to the NRC exercise, those who came after the 24th of March 1971, they will be declared as illegal migrants. Whereas, those who came before the midnight of 24th March 1971, they would be accepted as Indian citizens. This flimsy distinction which has been created has provided an opportunity to target the minorities, because the entire process of proving one's citizenship is based on one's ability to provide the required documents. Now let's take up an article from page number 4, which refers to the National Action Plan for Drug Demand Reduction. This program is an initiative of the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment with the objective of reducing drug demand and counter drug abuse and substance abuse amongst teenagers. The National Action Plan for Drug Demand Reduction has been developed by the National Institute of Social Defense, which is under the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment. And as a part of this program, 126 districts have been identified as high-risk areas. In these 127 high-risk districts, the prevalence of drug abuse and substance abuse is very high. The program will exclusively focus on these districts, and it will establish outreach centers in order to provide for counseling and rehabilitation. And in order to establish and run these outreach centers, the National Institute of Social Defense and the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment will be tying up with various NGOs which have expertise in dealing with drug abuse. And the program will also provide for a community-based peer-led intervention under which students will be trained to reach out to their fellow students and discourage them from getting addicted to drugs and narcotics. Next, we have an article on page 8 which refers to the Gaganyaan mission. An agreement has been signed between the Indian Air Force and ISRO to provide for selection and training of astronauts who will be a part of the Gaganyaan mission. The MOU has been signed between the Institute of Aerospace Medicine, which is based out of Bengaluru. And this institute, which is under the Indian Air Force, specializes in the field of aerospace medicine. So through the Institute of Aerospace Medicine, the Indian Air Force will collaborate with ISRO and they will jointly select and train the astronauts who will be a part of the Gaganyaan mission. The Gaganyaan mission is an ambitious project of ISRO, which was announced by the Prime Minister last year. This would be India's first human space mission. And as a part of this mission, 3 Indian astronauts will be on board a crew module which will be placed in a low Earth orbit of around 400 kilometers, and it will orbit around the Earth for a period of around 7 days, during which the astronauts will be conducting a variety of microgravity experiments. This mission would mark India's entry into the domain of human space flights, and it is expected to be launched in 2022. So as a part of this tie-up between the Indian Air Force and ISRO, suitable candidates will be selected, most likely from the Indian Air Force itself, and they will be adequately trained by both the organizations. And by 2020, a shortlist of 10 candidates would be selected. Out of these 10 candidates, 3 will be chosen to be a part of the ambitious Gaganyaan mission. And for further details about the Gaganyaan mission, you can watch a detailed video which is available on our YouTube channel. Next, we have an article on page number 9, which refers to the National Clean Air Program, which was recently launched in January 2019 by the Ministry of Environment and Forest. The National Clean Air Program plans to tackle air pollution, especially particulate matter pollution, and its objective is to reduce PM pollution by around 20% to 30% by the year 2024. So it is essentially a 5-year plan which will be implemented in 102 cities. And the program will focus on reducing PM10 and as well as PM2.5 pollution. Reducing PM10 and PM2.5 concentration levels is the main focus of this program, because PM10 and PM2.5 are directly responsible for a number of respiratory disorders. And 2017 has been selected as a base year to measure the PM levels and ensure that PM levels are brought down by around 20 to 30% by 2024 as compared to the PM levels which were present in 2017. And the National Clean Air Program provides for a customized plan for each city. It provides for a city-specific plan to tackle PM pollution. And the article says that 84 out of the 102 cities have already submitted their respective plans to the Ministry of Environment and Forest. And the central government will review these plans submitted by 84 cities before the World Environment Day, which is celebrated on the 5th of June. And in order to achieve these targets, the National Clean Air Program will provide for increasing the number of monitoring stations in the target cities. It will provide the required technological support, and it will even sponsor studies to understand the sources of PM pollution. And it will also work very closely with the state governments and the State Pollution Control Board in order to strengthen enforcement and reduce the emissions of particulate matter in these urban areas. And the program will not only focus on reducing industrial and vehicular pollution, but it will also try to ensure that the roads are free from potholes, because the presence of potholes and the occurrence of traffic jams will directly contribute to an increased level of particulate matter in the atmosphere. The program will also focus on reducing dust which is emitted from the construction sites, and it will take strict action against any unauthorized brick factories which are operating around cities, because brick factories also contribute significantly to particulate matter pollution. Next, on page number 10, we have an editorial which tries to analyze the significance of the invite which has been extended to the BIMSTEC leaders for the Prime Minister's swearing-in ceremony. But we have already covered this analysis in great detail on the 28th of May. So kindly go back and watch this video for further understanding. Because we have already covered most of the arguments which have been made in this editorial on the 28th of May itself. So let us take up the next article from page number 14. India has been removed from the currency monitoring list of the United States. This is a list which is maintained by the Department of Treasury of the United States. And if a country is placed on the currency monitoring list, it means that the US considers that country as a currency manipulator. The US Department of Treasury submits a semi-annual report to the US Congress, which evaluates the macroeconomic policies and the foreign exchange policies of the trading partners of the United States. In this report, which is submitted to the US Congress, the Department of Treasury evaluates the economic policies and foreign exchange policies of the major trading partners of the United States. And within this report, it maintains a currency monitoring list which identifies the countries which are indulging in currency manipulation. Because in a free market economy, the value of a currency should be driven by the market. But a few governments deliberately carry out a direct intervention in the currency market, and they will try to devalue the currency in order to gain an unfair trade advantage by making their exports more competitive. So if the currency of a country is deliberately devalued against market conditions, then it can create an unfair advantage for that country by making its exports more attractive and more competitive. So the United States considers such a direct intervention in the currency market as an unfair trade practice, and it labels those countries as currency manipulators by placing them on the currency monitoring list. And if a country is placed on the currency monitoring list of the Department of Treasury, then there would be economic consequences, because it can slow down the flow of investments into that country. So India had been placed on the currency monitoring list for the first time in May 2018. Basically, the US felt that India was carrying out unfair trade practices by deliberately devaluing its currency. And the US believed that India's intervention in the foreign exchange market and in the currency market was creating an unfair advantage for India's exports with regard to its trade with the United States. So that's the reason why India was placed on the currency monitoring list of the United States back in 2018. And along with India, even countries like China, Switzerland, etc. were also placed on the currency monitoring list. But in the latest report, which has been submitted by the Department of Treasury to the US Congress, India and Switzerland have been removed from the list because apparently both the countries have shown some improvement with regard to their intervention in the currency markets. The report says that India has been removed from the currency monitoring list because India has met only one out of the three criteria which are required to be listed on the currency monitoring list. For two consecutive reports, India has been meeting only one of the three criteria which are needed to be listed on the currency monitoring list. So that's the reason why India has been removed along with Switzerland from the currency monitoring list, which is maintained by the Department of Treasury. Let us quickly look at the criteria which is required to be listed on the currency monitoring list. The first criteria is that if a country has a current account surplus which is more than 2% of its GDP, then it is qualified to be placed on the currency monitoring list. The second criteria is that if a country has carried out a direct intervention in its currency markets and if it has deliberately devalued its currency, then it can be labeled as a currency manipulator and placed on the currency monitoring list. And the third criteria is that if the country has a bilateral trade surplus of more than $20 billion with the United States. And India meets only the third criteria which is needed to be placed on the currency monitoring list, because right now India's exports to the US is much higher than the quantity of imports from the US to India. So as a result, India's bilateral trade surplus with the US is more than $20 billion. But apart from this, India doesn't meet the other two criterias. So as a result, the Department of Treasury has removed India from the currency monitoring list and the US no longer considers India as a currency manipulator. Next, we have an article on page 14, which refers to an attack carried out by the Taliban near the Jam Minaret. The Jam Minaret is a UNESCO World Heritage Site and it is considered as the world's second tallest brick tower. And the Jam Minaret is considered to be a direct inspiration for the construction of the Qutub Minar in Delhi by the Delhi Sultanate. This reminds us of the destruction of the Bamiyan Buddhist statues by the Taliban when they captured power back in 1996. And this also highlights the threat posed by civil wars and radical groups for historical monuments and heritage sites. Now let's take up an article from page 22. Recently, SpaceX, which is owned by Elon Musk, launched around 60 satellites into a low Earth orbit as a part of the Starlink constellation. The Starlink constellation of satellites, which are being launched by SpaceX, is designed to provide high-speed internet across the world through satellites. In order to complete the constellation, SpaceX is planning to launch around 12,000 satellites into orbit, and it will literally provide global coverage, and it will deliver high-speed internet even to the remotest areas of Earth. And the launch of the first batch of satellites has caused a lot of concern amongst astronomers. Because the first batch of 60 satellites which were launched, they have been placed in a low Earth orbit. They all share the same orbit and they appear like a satellite train. And this satellite train is visible to the naked eye because the solar panels on these satellites are reflecting the sunlight back to Earth. So when the satellite train was spotted in a few European countries, it triggered a lot of panic because many believed it to be an unidentified flying object or an alien object. But this is not the concern that astronomers are worried about. Astronomers are worried that the reflection of sunlight by the solar panels of the Starlink constellation can inhibit astronomical observation. Because the sunlight reflected back by the solar panels contributes to light pollution, and this in turn can hamper space observation, which is carried out through ground-based telescopes. And if this is the extent of problem created by around 60 satellites, then you can imagine the challenges if 12,000 satellites are launched into orbit by SpaceX. Currently, there are only around 2,100 satellites which are in orbit. These are the live satellites which are present. And if SpaceX alone adds around 12,000 satellites as a part of the Starlink constellation, it can not only hamper space observation through telescopes, it can even create a lot of space debris, which can pose a direct threat to the future of rocket launches and satellites and spacecrafts which are in orbit. But SpaceX has tried to address these concerns by saying that these satellites will be raised in their orbit and they will be finally placed at an altitude of 550 kilometers, and this will ensure that the satellite train will not be visible to the naked eye, and as a result it may not hamper space research and space observation which is carried out through telescopes. Now let's take up the practice questions. Which of the following articles prohibits religious instruction in any educational institution which is wholly maintained out of state funds? The correct answer is option D, Article 28. Now let's take up the second question. The President of India administers the oath of office and secrecy to the Prime Minister, the Cabinet Ministers, the Council of Ministers. The correct answer is option D, all the above. Now let's take up the third question. Which of the following statements are correct? SpaceX is a private American aerospace manufacturer and space transportation services company. It was founded by Elon Musk with the goal of reducing space transportation costs and enabling the colonization of Mars. Both the statements are correct, so option C is the correct answer. In fact, SpaceX is playing the lead role in the development of reusable rocket technology, which can bring down space transportation costs. And it also has an ambitious plan to colonize Mars in the future. So option C is the correct answer. Now let's take up a map-based question. Which of the following countries share a land border with Iran? The correct answer is option C, 1 and 3 only. It's only Turkey and Pakistan which share a land border with Iran, whereas Jordan does not share a land border with Iran. Please look at the map. Turkey shares a direct land border with Iran, and the same applies for Pakistan as well. Whereas Jordan is located over here and it does not share a boundary with Iran. The other neighboring countries of Iran includes Iraq, Armenia, Azerbaijan, Turkmenistan, Afghanistan, etc. Now let's take up a question from the 2017 prelims paper. What is the application of somatic cell nuclear transfer technology? The correct answer is option C, reproductive cloning of animals. So this concludes our discussion for the day. Thanks for watching.